Good afternoon. I'm so pleased to welcome you to this important conversation on how we can help more Americans feel their voices represented in Congress. Since 2018, the American Academy's Nonpartisan Commission on the Practice of Democratic Citizenship has been working to address the weaknesses and vulnerabilities in our political and civic life. The Commission's influential report, Our Common Purpose, Reinventing American Democracy for the 21st Century, advances 31 bold recommendations for building a more resilient and responsive democracy. In the listening sessions that informed the report, and in the subsequent years of work to make these recommendations a reality, the Commission has maintained a commitment to consulting with Americans from all walks of life. Time after time, we have encountered a prevailing sense of crisis, a belief that voting does not matter, consensus that institutions are non-responsive and non-representative, and waning faith in democracy itself. Recommendations in Our Common Purpose attack this crisis from multiple angles, from suggestions for social media reform to specific changes to our voting practices. Among the recommendations intended to achieve equality of voice and recommendation is recommendation 1.3, which calls for revamping of the 1967 law preventing multi-member congressional districts. Today's conversation will highlight this solution and explore its potential to help Americans feel more represented in the United States Congress, contributing to the virtuous cycle that the Commission aims to inspire, in which responsive political institutions foster a healthy civic culture, and a healthy civic culture inspires responsive political institutions. The American Academy is proud to be co-hosting this event along with our partners at Unite America, and we are grateful to all our speakers for their time and insight. It's my pleasure to turn things over to Commission member and founder of the Millennial Action Project, Stephen Olikara, who will moderate today's discussion. The Millennial Action Project is the largest nonpartisan organization of young elected leaders in the U.S. Stephen, thank you for your service on the Commission and for driving today's conversation. Stephen.
Well, absolutely. Thank you, David. And thanks to everyone for tuning in to this important conversation on proportional representation. And as David mentioned, our commission and the resulting report, Our Common Purpose, touched on a number of different areas to renew American democracy. And one of the areas that has definitely gotten some of the most attention is the recommendations around electoral reform. And so that is the focus of this conversation. And we're lucky to have four distinguished leaders and experts in electoral reform to help this conversation. And as we go through questions, get ready for some Q&A at the very end. So you all will have the chance to ask some questions directly of our panelists. So just to introduce our panel very briefly, we have Andy Craig, who is a scholar at the Cato Institute and the director of election policy at the Rainey Center, and there he focuses on election law and electoral reform. We also have Norm Ornstein, who is a legend in our space. He is an emeritus scholar at the American Enterprise Institute and has been studying politics in Congress for over four decades. We have Alora Thomas-Lundborg, who is the director of strategic litigation and advocacy for the Charles Hamilton Houston Institute for Race and Justice at Harvard Law School. And previously she worked on voting rights at the ACLU. And finally, we have Grant Tudor, who is a policy advocate at Protect Democracy and the recent author of a groundbreaking report on proportional representation, which in many ways was the premise for this conversation to be convened. And one brief note I'll make before we jump into the conversation is a warm welcome from Door County, Wisconsin, where I am currently. This is a popular getaway spot in Wisconsin. Some of it, you may be familiar with it. And I think the perfect place to be discussing electoral reform. One other brief note, David mentioned my organization, Millennial Action Project, which works with young elected officials across the country. And working on electoral reforms has been a long time focus of ours in a bipartisan way. And I think one opportunity we're seeing with proportional representation and with multi-member districts is we are seeing alignment between Democrats and Republicans. And I think it's the hope of all of us to be able to keep it that way. So with that, we're going to start with Grant. You are the author of this seminal report on proportional representation. And just to provide a little context for everyone, I think in the reform space, there's been a longstanding conversation on reforms related to, for example, campaign finance reform. I would say over the last 10 to 15 years, a strong emphasis on gerrymandering reform and the importance of creating nonpartisan redistricting commissions. That's popping up more and more at the state level. Over the last 5 to 6 years, a strong emphasis on the need for nonpartisan open primaries and ranked choice voting. And so now in that context, Grant, help everyone understand, why should proportional representation in multi-member districts not only be on that agenda, but perhaps one of the most important reforms that we could be pursuing? And just to help everyone from a starting point here, what is proportional representation? What are the fundamentals of what you're proposing here?
Sure. Thanks, Stephen. And it's great to be here. So let me start with the latter. I'll do kind of the quick 90-second crash course in PR, and then we can move to some of the reasons that organizations like ours are kind of taking a heightened interest in the proposal. First and foremost, if there are political scientists in the room, you will need to forgive me in advance for the overly simple answer to this question. But very generally, there are two major classes of electoral systems in the world, or the systems that translate votes into seats. The first is winner take all, which is what we use for all of our state and federal legislative elections in the US. And then there's PR, some version of which is used in most democracies today. Under winner take all, a single candidate wins in each district, right? So if you get 51% of the vote, you get 100% of the representation. You win the single seat and are the sole representative for that district. By contrast, under PR, there are multiple seats up for grabs in a district, and those seats are allocated proportionally to votes won. So for example, if a party gets 50% of the vote in say a 6-seat district, it would win 3 seats. So 50% of the vote translates into 50% of the seats, not 100. So that's the basic kind of mechanical difference. And in a really straightforward sense, you know, advocates understandably talk about how PR like tends to be a fairer system, right? So in Massachusetts today, for example, the electorate, don't quote me exactly, but is about a third Republican. But Republicans have 0 of the state's 9 congressional seats because of winner take all. Whereas under PR, they probably have a third or, you know, 3. So this kind of generally describes, I think, how these systems diverge. This is also ultimately about a lot more than partisan fairness. So let me just kind of tick through, to answer the first part of the question, kind of a few of the key benefits that at least jump out to us from the literature as some of the more striking effects of kind of how these different systems operate. First, PR systems tend to feature much less affective polarization, or kind of how much we dislike one another and not just disagree with one another. And researchers think that's largely because PR creates space for more parties, rather than this kind of binary us versus them that's at risk of happening in a strictly two-party system. So that's number one. Number two, another benefit of creating space for more parties and therefore PR is the potential for giving currently politically homeless voters a home and a way then to meaningfully engage in politics. So, you know, think about a lot of the center-right voters who today don't really see themselves in the current Republican Party. You know, under winner-take-all, creating a new party is basically a fruitless endeavor, and we can go into more as to why that's the case later. But under PR, it's more feasible. PR systems also tend to feature a lot more competition. So there are just simply far fewer of what we call safe districts here. And that's largely because PR is less sensitive to what's termed geographic sorting, or kind of red and blue voters increasingly living in similar places that create these lopsided districts. It's also, to touch on gerrymandering, it's also very difficult, if not impossible, to gerrymander under PR, another kind of driver of decreased competition. And then finally, kind of last flag is, you know, racial and ethnic minorities tend to elect more candidates of choice under PR. And that's just a function of kind of simple math, right? If you're 30% of the electorate in a district, you're likely to get some representation as opposed to none. So big picture, I think kind of the system that we've kind of taken as a given in the US, winner take all, it's both increasingly unusual. There's only a few major democracies left that use it. And it's probably contributing to kind of a whole host of issues that are disaffecting our politics.
Excellent. Well, thank you, Grant, for that. And I'm going to move to Norm now. As I mentioned in the introduction, there's probably no one in our country who spent more time thinking about understanding and analyzing Congress than Norm Ornstein. So, Norm, when you think about proportional representation, multi-member districts, how do you think that would impact Congress in practice based on everything that you've seen over the years? And also briefly mentioned that, Norm, you served alongside me as a member on this commission. So maybe you can give a little bit of perspective from your experience on the commission as well.
Sure. And thank you, Stephen. And thanks for all that you're doing. So, you know, the commission really had a broad range of views, and we were looking for ways of dealing with what in this space, I would say, are three sets of problems. We have a polarized political system, we have a tribalized political system, and we have a political system that increasingly has distorted a, you could even say, not just a democracy, but a Republican form of democracy. We know all kinds of people who say, we're a republic, not a democracy. But in a republic, of course, the idea is you elect representatives who then represent you. And if they're not representing you, we end up with a distorted system. Now, I will say just with one little caveat on what Grant said, you know, Canada has single member first past the post districts, but in a parliamentary system, you can accommodate more parties, and then you can find ways of building coalitions, and there are homes for people that they can have, and you can, you know, work out different kinds of coalitions that can develop. Our political system just doesn't have any flexibility to do that. And with polarization, what's happened is that our parties, you know, to use a cliche that used to be, at least for much of our lifetimes, broad tents, where lots of people with different views could find themselves at least accommodated. That doesn't happen anymore. We have large numbers of people who just don't believe that there's a home in either of our two dominant political parties. And if there is a third party out there or an independent alternative, the way our system works, it ends up distorting results rather than giving people voices and actually creating something that's more representative. Think, for example, in a presidential election of a Ralph Nader, a Pat Buchanan, a Jill Stein, who couldn't win, but could end up flipping an election in a direction that doesn't necessarily reflect voters. So we have to look for ways of dealing with that. The tribalism is a bigger cultural problem, but we've got to start somewhere, and structural reform becomes a way of dealing with it. And then we have the other structural anomalies that occur. A House of Representatives that is supposed to represent people and votes are supposed to translate into what voters want. That is increasingly less true. Some of that is because, as Grant mentioned, the gerrymandering that we have, but it's not just that. It's that with our system, it's possible to draw districts that become safe for one party, and then the competition takes place at the extremes. It's always in the primaries that occur. So what do we do about some of those things that can at least ameliorate the issues structurally? And this is where multi-member districts, and then you have to find a way, a form of ranked choice voting, can work better. And here, Stephen, let me just briefly mention one example that we have in our history. Illinois, for many decades before the 1960s, in its state house, had three-person districts. They were bigger, more heterogeneous than a single district would be. And voters had three votes to cast. You could do three for one candidate, two for one for another, or one for each of three. So what happened? What happened is you got a wider range of candidates. And for the candidates, instead of having an incentive to just appease the base of your own party, which often is the more extreme group, you had a real incentive to try to reach out and at least get second place votes, get one vote from a set of voters who might not prefer you. So that meant that they moved in a different direction with a different kind of dialogue in a campaign, polarizing dialogue, focusing on those wedge issues became less significant. And instead, it became more appropriate to reach out a little bit more broadly. And as Grant said, with districts of that sort, it becomes much more difficult to gerrymander, to skew them in a particular direction. So if we combined multi-member districts with a form of ranked choice voting, there is a pretty good chance that we would end up with members of Congress who tended to be more sensitive to all of the voters in their districts, who would reach out more broadly, who would use less divisive tribal rhetoric in what they were doing. And since in our country, we have been moving increasingly, especially in one party, towards extreme rhetoric and towards a division rather than finding ways to reach out more broadly, this would be a very sizable step in a good direction to try and move us back a little bit towards a robust democracy. You're still going to have different points of view and vigorous debate, but not the kind of deep, divisive, and dangerous politics that we've had in our Congress in recent years.
Yep, that's right. And just adding to Norm's excellent comments here, through my experience working with a lot of elected officials, you will have some that have enormous courage and who can challenge the system and cut against the grain to serve the broader public, often at the expense of their own political career. But that's a very small number of people. Most of the elected officials I've worked with are very much looking to the incentives so that they can get reelected. And that's why all of these incentives that Grant and Norm are talking about really do matter in practice. When a legislator is deciding whether or not they're going to sign on to a piece of legislation, these incentives matter. Who are they hearing from? Who are they really responding to? So great comments all around. And now I'm going to move to Alora, because you've litigated election law cases throughout the country, including gerrymandering cases and cases under the Voting Rights Act. And so from your litigation experience, which is a huge arena for electoral work, how does that perspective inform your thinking when it comes to proportional representation?
Hi, thank you for that question. So I consider myself primarily a civil rights litigator who's focusing on issues of racial justice, and that's the lens in which I think about all of these issues. And to date, when we think about litigation, for the most part, litigation has been focused on putting guardrails on our current system. So not, as Grant explained, there are these two systems, first past the post, winner take all, or you can have a PR system. And for the most part, what litigation has been focused on is trying to import concepts of proportionality into our winner take all system. And one of the questions that comes up for litigators is, when you're thinking about proportionality, are we talking about party or race, especially if you're a civil rights litigator like myself? And the cases have quite frankly diverged and have a divergent history. So kind of starting with party, which we spent a lot of time talking about, that has all been mostly focused through the partisan gerrymandering context. So in 2018, I spearheaded a case in Ohio, a partisan gerrymandering case in Ohio, which at the time had one of the starkest partisan skews in the country, where four of the 16 seats were held by Democrats, even though, even to this day, Democrats tend to get anywhere from like 45 to 49% of the vote, but we're still only getting 25% of the seats of the Ohio congressional delegation. So we brought a case, and while our case was pending, the Supreme Court decided Rucho v. Common Cause and said that partisan gerrymandering cases are not judiciable in federal courts. So you all leave federal courts, the options are a legislative solution at Congress, or you could go to state court. So we went to state court. The state court cases have been ongoing. But before the 2022 election, we had brought a case. There had been some movement. But even still, if we look at the 2022 election in Ohio, the gains that we were able to get up to that point in litigation was only 5 out of the 15 seats. So an improvement on proportionality, but certainly not a proportional result. If you look at the Senate election that year, Tim Ryan got 47% of the vote to J.D. Vance's 53%. So while clearly a Republican majority state, not one in such that you would think Democrats would get such a low percentage of the vote. On the other side of cases that I've worked on is the Section 2 cases. And we did try to be very cognizant, just going back to Ohio for a second, is thinking about racial minorities when we brought that case. So at the time, Ohio had what we would call a Section 2 district, a majority Black district. We were very cognizant of that district being there, doing our own racial justice analysis, our own Section 2 analysis to think about how our map should be constructed. And that's something that I think we should keep in mind as we think about proposals, is not just treating racial and ethnic minorities and their representation as afterthoughts, but making sure that they are brought to the forethought. And that's something that we've been doing and thinking about at the Institute. So on the other side of the ledger has been the Section 2 cases. In Section 2, the Supreme Court just reaffirmed in Milligan that Section 2 is not a proportionality standard, but you do use proportionality as at least a starting point to figuring out if there's a problem. So under the Section 2 analysis, it's whether the vote has been diluted of a minority group in a particular location, and that's whether the minority group can elect candidates of choice. And one way that you start off by figuring out if that's happening is looking at the conversion of the population to the seat. So I'm currently involved in litigation in Louisiana, both in the state legislature and in Congress. And so I'll just use Congress as an example. In Louisiana, there's 6 congressional seats, only one of which African Americans have been able to elect a candidate of their choice. So African Americans are 30% of the vote. They're only translating that into 16% of the vote. So clearly an issue, but then once you've identified an issue, you have to identify all the other steps that the Supreme Court requires to say that this issue is something that can be remedied under Section 2. And I won't bore you with all the requirements, but it's about the geography of the state. It's about the history of the state. It's about the voting, the racial voting timing of the state. And so in order to actually win a litigation, you have to put all these pieces into place. And you can't just look at the proportional translation of seats to vote shares. So in fact, what we found is Section 2 is a great tool that we have, but it's a limited tool. It's further limited by the fact that the Supreme Court, in a line of cases called Shaw, explicitly said, what we care about is winner take all, first past the post. Can you draw one of those districts? If you cannot draw one of those districts, then no luck. You're out of court, including you can't draw districts of coalitions of minority groups who might vote similarly, might have coalitions for various causes that they care about. That's not sufficient to have a Section 2 remedy. So Section 2 is a tool that we have, but it is a limited tool, and it's within the construct of what the system that we already have in place. There have been some limited, though, at the local level, pushes in Section 2 towards proportional systems in city council cases and cases with school districts and at-large systems. Sometimes the remedy has been cumulative voting. So a cumulative voting system is similar to what Norm was talking about in Illinois, where, let's say, Ferguson was one of the cases the ACLU had. I was not on the case, but I'm aware of the case, where there were 6 seats in the school board. Each person gets to vote, and you can decide how you want to allocate those votes. That was the outcome, and in fact, we found that the use of cumulative voting as a remedy did help remedy the lack of translation of votes to seats in the school board. LEF had a similar case out of Pleasant Grove in Alabama. I believe that was a city council case where also the remedy was cumulative voting. So there are some ways in which Section 2 has been used at the local level to push toward a more proportional system, but it is limited by our laws and has not been used and cannot be used currently at Congress or at other higher levels of government. I think that's probably enough, but I'm happy to answer kind of more questions about the law and how we've been thinking about these things.
Excellent, excellent. All very, very good comments, Alora. And I think I saw some comments in the chat from our friends at FairVote, and I just want to give them a shout out because they were talking about this issue years before there was a broader conversation on it. And I believe Rob Ritchie of FairVote was the first person to tell me about the virtues of multi-member districts and proportional representation. So just want to give them a shout out here. Well, we're going to move to Andy. Andy, you're a scholar with the Cato Institute, which many of us know is a more libertarian-leaning institute and done incredible work related to electoral reform. And so I'd love to hear from your perspective, Andy, how you'd frame the libertarian case for proportional representation and multi-member districts.
Sure. Thanks. And thanks for everybody joining us here today. I think there's a lot to recommend proportional representation from a kind of lowercase l libertarian free market right of center perspective. I mean, one thing about it is that the political science perspective on this really goes to incentives and the effects of the structural design. And that overlaps a lot with a kind of Hayekian analysis. I mean, F.A. Hayek didn't write about this issue in particular, but he wrote this sort of comparative analysis and considering how we would design legislatures and, you know, our constitutional design. And that also goes straight back to the Madisonian tradition. Grant's report does a great job of discussing how, even though proportional representation as such hadn't been invented yet, they didn't really have it. The founders talked a lot about how their goals were proportionality. And there you see this kind of proto-proportionality rhetoric when you really dig in. There's a quote from John Adams where he talks about creating a portrait of society in miniature and the importance of having every voice heard and everybody represented. So I think that goes to part of it. Part of it is the polarization that we've seen has illiberalizing effects. And when you have what really amounts to minority rule, no matter which party is in power, because it's the small slice of voters in the primary electorate who have the real power, it's easy to pass a lot of things that wouldn't pass if you required more of a consensus. You know, a lot of libertarian-minded people are fond of supermajority mechanisms. You can think about this in the same way. This is taking it from needing legislators representing effectively maybe 15% of the voters to really having to require legislators who represent a majority of the voters in order to get things passed and to implement new laws. So that can have a salutary policy effect from a limited government perspective. And I think when we're looking at the, in particular, the kind of system that Grant has proposed and that's realistically on the table in the United States for the at the federal level, but similarly at the state legislative level, of having districts of 3 to 5 members, more or less in that range, single digits. I don't think, as much as a lot of us in the kind of poli-sci world are strong believers in the benefits of a multi-party system over a two-party system, I don't think this would necessarily produce a large number of third-party wins. To get a little bit in the weeds, the district magnitude is very small, the number of seats. So the percentage of the vote you need, it's not like some countries where if you get 3 or 5% nationwide, you get seats. You'd have to get up into the double digits to win a seat in these districts. But the big difference it would make, I mean, you might get one here or there, third-party members, But in each major party caucus in Congress, about a third of them would be from areas where they're local minority. It would be that 20 or 30% of relatively more moderate or fiscally conservative Democrats who live in rural counties, are and vice versa. Some of those, might be more socially liberal, low tax, pro-business Republicans who live in the downtown area and work in one of those fields that brings them that area. And they're still 10, 15, 20% of the vote in these districts. And they're currently unrepresented. And that's kind of the missing middle of American politics. And a lot of us believe that the American strain of lowercase l, broadly classical liberalism is found more strongly in the center, and that voice is being underrepresented. So it also goes to a lot of the concerns you hear on the right about gerrymandering. That's not just a complaint from the left. There's a lot of dissatisfaction with the arbitrary nature of when you have to have, for good reasons, equal populations in these single member districts, that the human geography doesn't map very neatly onto that. You have to do these awkward things where you split a town and you go over and grab a part of another. You can't respect county lines in the way that a lot of state legislatures did before the one man, one vote rulings. And you get into this business with, like was touched on, majority minority districts. There's good reasons, I think, why we kind of strive to that as a kind of quasi-proportional replacement, and grappling with the fact that we don't even have a good way to define what's gerrymandering other than referring to proportionality, which is not supposed to be the legal standard, and yet we don't really have any other workable one. But it's not ideal to have to be drawing districts based on race. And I think some of the pushback, the resentment of having to do that is not entirely baseless, but there's a better way to do it that solves this. Which is that if you're 30% or 20% or whatever the case may be, that's how many seats you get. You don't have to go about carving up red and blue districts where effectively the map drawing decides what the state's partisan and in many cases racial delegation will be for a decade at a time, instead of by the voters every 2 years in November.
Right. Yeah. Well, you anticipated one of my questions on kind of the relationship with gerrymandering, and I think you're exactly right there. So we're going to kind of open up the conversation a little broader here. And one piece of the conversation that certainly needs to be addressed around proportional representation is the role of the 1967 Uniform Congressional District Act, which governs a lot of these related laws. And I'm going to go to Grant here, because I know you addressed this directly in the report. What would we be looking for? First of all, what is the Uniform Congressional District Act? And secondly, what would we be looking to amend that piece of law to serve the larger goal of proportional representation?
Sure. So I'll start with kind of clarifying what the actual law is. It's relatively straightforward, but it is the principal legal obstacle to even beginning to contemplate experimenting with proportional representation, at least at the federal level. So for folks learning about this statute for the first time, it's a federal mandate passed in 1967 that simply requires states to use single member districts for House elections. I want to also just kind of underscore that unlike a lot of other kind of big structural reform proposals out there that require, say, constitutional change, like this is a matter of regular lawmaking, of amending a federal statute. So in some respects, this kind of puts the potential for PR in kind of a different category. So the short answer here is that in the founding era, and I promise this is a short answer, even though I'm mentioning the founding era, the U.S. inherited winner-take-all from Great Britain. Like, it was really the only system, as Andy kind of referenced at the time. But winner-take-all came in two different varieties. Variety number one is what we use now, single-member districts. And then the other variety is what's called block voting, which uses multi-member districts, but where winners are allocated by a plurality of the vote and not allocated proportionally. So without getting into the details, in effect, a single party still tends to win an entire district, sweep all of the seats, rather than winning in proportion to votes won. The important point that kind of brings us to the statute is that block voting is an especially non-proportional system. So even though single member districts aren't great, they do offer the opportunity for some minority representation, partisan or otherwise, if those minorities are geographically concentrated enough. So there was this tug of war for a very long time, over a century, between states that use single member districts and states that use block voting. By the mid 20th century, by the 60s, there were only, I think, two states left that used block voting. But in the wake of the VRA, and generally in response to the civil rights movement, Southern states began threatening the use of block voting to basically just entirely nullify the voting strength of Black voters. So the single member mandate kind of came about, put to rest this debate over the two winner take all models. So maybe just kind of wrap this, I think it's important to recognize that two things here with the kind of history of the UCDA, two things here are true at once, which is that the UCDA was a really important milestone in fending off threats to further dilute minority voting power, especially in the South. And at the same time, it also foreclosed the ability of the US to experiment with more proportional alternatives. So as much of the democratic world would go on to adopt and iterate various versions of PR, we've now been kind of locked into the lesser of two evils kind of ever since 1967.
Yeah, very good. And I just want to give a heads up to everyone who's tuning in. Within a couple minutes, we'll formally go to our Q&A session of this conversation. But one thing we have been hearing from some of the questions is just trying to better understand proportional representation versus ranked choice voting. And so with this, I'm going to go to you, Norm, because you referenced ranked choice voting and have been a big advocate of that. Maybe just help people understand the distinctions between the two and then also how they can work together.
Sure. And Stephen, I think we should emphasize to people, we're not in our constitutional structure going to move to the kind of proportional representation that we see in parliamentary systems in countries like the Netherlands or Israel, where you vote basically for a party and then the parties get seats in the legislature based on the proportion of votes that were achieved, and then they choose the candidates who end up serving. And you can take that to an extreme, as they've done in a country like Israel, where you, at this point, they actually raise the threshold, but you only need 2.5% of the votes to be able to get any representation in a pretty small legislature known as the Knesset, only 120 members. And that can distort things too much. You want to be careful about what you do with proportional representation. But without a system like that, with one that has the separately elected House and Senate, with one where the Senate seats are, you know, fixed in the Constitution that you're going to get 2 per state, we're not going to be able to move in that direction. So what we're talking about is a kind of hybrid model. And it's one that moves us more towards trying to make sure that the preferences of voters are not frozen out for large numbers of people. In some cases, you know, Alora mentioned Ohio. We've had instances in Wisconsin where a majority of voters voted for one party for their legislature, and that party got less than a third or around a third of all the seats in the legislature. So that's the kind of distortion that you don't want to see happen. We're trying to move towards something where the representation is more roughly proportional to the preferences of voters. And Stephen, before we go, I want to make a larger point here. Our system is moving in a very bad direction if you're looking for a sense of legitimacy in a democracy. It's the House that we've talked about. It's the Electoral College, where from 1824, when we first really started to count popular votes, up through 1996, 44 elections, you had one or two where you could really say that the winner of the popular vote lost the presidency. 2 out of the last 6. And you continue to move in a direction where the popular vote does not translate into the presidency, and people are going to question legitimacy. In our Senate, we're almost at a point where 70% of Americans live in just 15 of our 50 states, which means that 30% of the country will elect 70 of the 100 senators. And they're not representative of the diversity of the country or the economic dynamism of the country. Increasingly, voters are going to say, I'm voting, it isn't working. So where can we turn? It's harder to deal with the Senate. It's not easy to deal with the Electoral College, although we try modestly with that in another one of our recommendations to enlarge the House, which is another part that fits in with what we're talking about here. But here we can have an impact on what's supposed to be the people's house and move it in a direction where it comes closer to where people vote and those votes translate into their preferences in the people who represent them. That's what we're talking about. Ranked choice voting is a part of this, is what enables people in a model, whether it's one like the Illinois or others that we could choose, where you're going to find that voices of minorities are not frozen out of the system, and that's minorities of all different sorts, but end up in some fashion, more even if it's rougher, being accommodated in the system and representative in some way. That's what we're aiming toward, and that's what some of these recommendations aim to do.
Exactly. And we're just getting a comment in the chat about expanding the number of congressional districts. We've been stuck at 435 for 100 years. And as Norm said, that was certainly a big part of our common purpose report. And so feel free to keep sending questions into the chat, and we'll get to as many as we can. But one theme of a number of the comments coming in relate to both state level and international examples that we could draw us from. So I'm going to go to both Alora and Andy on this. Alora, first to you, involved at the state level on a number of fronts, are there any proof points that we should be looking to as examples? And then subsequently, Andy, I'll go to you for more of the international perspective. But Alora, do you want to just jump in on some of the state examples that we could be looking at?
So I've been less involved with some of the state action. I mean, the ones that I am most familiar with are the kind of local translation of seats of votes that have happened in the litigations that I named. So if we look at Ferguson, which previously had an at-large system, and I think this goes back to Grant's point, is when we think about what system we are moving toward, and as we think about proportionality, we just have to make sure that we're not assuming we're just going to get rid of districts and we're going to solve the problems of translation to seats of votes. That's not, if we just look at our kind of state, our state offices, that's not the case. Going back to the Ohio example, it's a state that is 47% Democrat, and yet it is wholly Republican controlled. And so the benefit, as we think about how do we translate seats to votes of a multi-party system, is that our multi-seat system, sorry, is that you are actually translating the votes versus a state total at-large system. And as we think about proposals, particularly proposals at the state level, that's something that I'm always kind of keeping in mind.
Excellent. Thank you. And Andy, any international examples we should be looking to here?
Sure. Just briefly on the state point, I mean, I would mention that the state legislatures are really the place to kind of pursue as the laboratories of democracy, this model that we're talking about at the federal level for House. And there's been quite a bit of interest in Wyoming, for example, the deepest red state in the country. There's a desire to get back to multi-member districts and county-based districts because that's the system they used to have. And there's court rulings to which they went to single-member districts. But now they realize how PR potentially in that discussion, I mean, it's taken for granted that any kind of return to multi-member districts would depend on using PR for Voting Rights Act compliance, among other things. But on the international level, I mean, as Norm mentioned, there's kind of the extreme end, which is a very low threshold thing. This touches on what I mentioned with district magnitude and the effective threshold you get from that, the number of seats, basically there are up how much, you know, if you get down to 2% of the vote, you get fracturing. I mean, effectively, this decides how fractured the party system is. It's very predictable from the data. And you can have, on the one end, a system more like what you see in Switzerland or Germany, which has something closer to what we're discussing here with multi-member districts, and also a federal system that kind of forces that kind of smaller districts. You see 3 to 5 parties, give or take, that are really viable and get representation. And there's a lot of reasons to think that's kind of the sweet spot. So in the American context, it's true that we have a presidential system, which is winner take all. We have winner take all U.S. Senate. We have state governors who are independently elected, and that's a winner take all race. So, you know, it's kind of an open question exactly how much party fracturing we would get. But when we're there are examples of more presidential or quasi presidential systems that still have a multi-party dynamic where some there are, even if there's two dominant parties, there are third and fourth and fifth parties that are represented. So I think that in a best case scenario, that's the kind of model we should look to. I would really point to kind of Germany and Switzerland, which has other potential benefits I like, but that's not so much. Italy was historically not anymore. They changed it, but I had a very low threshold, and that produced kind of chronic instability. You see in Israel with these, you know, super, there's 20 parties, and it's a crisis to assemble a majority government each time. So we're definitely not talking, I mean, it's not structurally possible in the United States to get to that kind of system where you would have that degree of party fracturing.
Right, right. Excellent. Well, this next question I'm going to pose to the entire panel, anyone can feel free to take this one, but a good question came in about how we build the diverse coalition needed to advance this idea. Any thoughts on coalition building from our panel here?
Well, I'll chime in with one thought that I think is kind of, there's a broad awareness of this in the electoral reform community, where there's a lot of us who agree on this, but it's a very cross-ideological coalition kind of naturally already among the scholars and activists on this. But ranked choice voting, which has been touched on, has kind of been the main big reform idea, has been adopted in Alaska and Maine, and has a lot of local implementation, has become more polarized. There has been increasing opposition to it on the right. And I think there's good counterarguments against that. There are a lot of Republicans out there who support ranked choice voting. It's being used on the municipal level in Utah, which is another, you know, very conservative Republican state. But there is, I think, an important desire to kind of avoid that and to recognize this is not just about, you know, it's not about boosting centrist as such. It's certainly not about making sure Democrats win more elections than Republicans. It's not that kind of thing. It's about having more accurate representation across the spectrum. If you're on the more conservative right in this, there are reasons why you would be better off under this system too. And so it's not a power grab. That's a negative misconception about it, but there is, I think, a strong desire to avoid that as we move forward working on PR.
Let me add, Stephen, that you know, on our commission we had broad support. Andy's right. This is something that for the non-elected office holder or national politician group, you can build a broader consensus. But we can't ignore the reality now that getting almost anything done structurally through Congress is a very heavy lift. And it's a heavy lift for a couple of reasons. One is for almost every member of Congress, they are by definition successful under the status quo. And anything that changes that status quo is going to make them uneasy. A second is, and I've found this, as I've talked about this with members, a lot of members, this is just not a top priority for them. It's almost never a top priority to do structural reform of their own institutions. You have to have a crisis or a set of champions who work on it night and day. We have some champions, but not enough. And then I think the third part is that right now, the Republican majority in the House is not going to countenance anything that is supported by the Democratic minority. There's going to be a suspicion that they're doing this for ulterior motives or insidious reasons. And there are some who believe that they don't represent a majority in the country and that anything that would provide broader representation is not going to serve their political interests. So we've got a lot of work to do to bring this to the politicians who will be making the decisions. It's not going to happen overnight, even though these are ideas that have no ideological tilt to them or partisan tilt.
Well, and Grant, feel free to jump in on that. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I do think there is some skepticism in parts of the civil rights community about PR and whether it's going to perform. And I think if we want to bring in the kind of minority civil rights activists, and there has to be real dedicated study to performance, not just a cross-national comparison, but looking at the specifics of the United States. And that's something that we're kind of starting to do at the Institute in our work. But take Section 2, and a Section 2 case comes down before a map is implemented. There's all kinds of really detailed expert analysis about how a particular remedy and map is going to perform for the communities and interests. And that's very locality and ethnicity specific when that analysis is done. And many advocates are concerned, given differential turnout rates of various minority communities, and also the kind of translation of voting age populations to overall population, about whether whether various models are going to work. And I think if we want to bring those folks on board, we have to engage in that analysis that speaks to those concerns of those communities and is actually taking them seriously.
Well said. Thank you, Laura. Grant, were you going to jump in? And also just maybe, I know you talk about this, the difference between the process of making a constitutional amendment happen, which is not what we're talking about here, versus a change in statute. But yeah, feel free to jump in.
Sure. I think I'll just quickly add to the question around kind of the coalition behind something like this. I think I can speak for Protect Democracy in general. I think we tend to be more optimistic, perhaps naively so, that there are coalitional possibilities within the current political parties, which I know sounds a little bit crazy. But the reason for that is something that actually Noor mentioned earlier, which is that, you know, neither party is a monolith. You know, the AOC famously, you know, said a few years back that in any other country, she and Joe Biden would never be in the same political party, right? I think the same thing is probably true of, you know, Mitt Romney and Donald Trump. But because of our very strict two-party system, they get clumped together. So I think kind of foremost, there really could be an appetite for folks who are currently Democrats or currently Republicans to find themselves in other parties that actually represents their values and policy programs better. So I just, you know, there's often, I think, in the electoral reform movement, an appetite to always work from the outside, because that's often what's necessary. And that might be the case here in part, but I think it would be, too soon to write off the fact that there really could be partners within the two major parties that might see some benefits to this.
That's right. We had an interesting question come in that I think really speaks to what's really driving a lot of this, which is how voters interact with their elected officials. And someone asked, under proportional representation in multi-member districts, who would I contact as my representative? So I love the spirit of that question. Anyone want to take that one?
I'll go for that. You could contact any of them. There are all your representative, but it would you probably have the most luck, and depending on what you're asking for or trying to push, with the one you voted for, which almost effectively everybody in the country would have. You could be a Democrat in a deep red district or state. You could be a Republican in a deep blue district or state, and you would have somebody who's not going to write you off in the same way as if you're a conservative trying to go to a very progressive Democratic representative or vice versa. So I think, you know, and when you're talking about constituent services, if anything, it will it's beneficial. Right now, it's kind of luck of the draw. Some members are very good at constituent services. Some members aren't. And this doesn't get a ton of attention outside of the overarching partisan narratives of elections. But if you have five or six or three representatives, you got a pretty good bet that one of them is going to be a pretty good conscientious, you know, provider of constituent services in terms of interacting with agencies and social security checks and visa issues and all those sorts of things that we really expect members to do outside of the big partisan debates.
Yeah, I would just add, that's right. It would be much better for you if there are three members and you can contact all of them, and all of them would have an incentive to listen to you, even if you're not their first choice. They might be able to get one vote out of the three if it's that kind of model. So it actually would be a big boon for responsiveness and constituent service, and probably even on issues where they're going to respond to you and they're going to try and take your views into account, because you can't just write somebody off. They'll never vote for me, so what do I care?
That's right. We just have about a minute left, but I do want to address an important question that came in, which is wondering how the political parties will feel about this reform and how we can get politicians who currently are succeeding in the current system on board with reform. And of course, we've heard a very similar question about reforms over the last few years around ranked choice voting, nonpartisan primaries. And so, Norm, I'll just go back to you very quickly, because you've seen these conversations evolve over the last four decades. How do you get politicians already in power to be on board with reform?
We have some champions out there. I'll mention a couple. Don Beyer of Virginia, Sean Casten of Illinois, have introduced bills to help us move in some of these directions and appropriate directions. But we need a lot more outreach. And we need outreach, especially to Republicans. I think Andy is right. There's no reason to believe that they will react against this because of their partisan needs or even their ideological views. But we're not finding as many of those who are at this point willing to champion what we're after. Get a few of those who can co-sponsor some of these bills, and we've got an opening, but we're not quite there yet.
Excellent. Well, this has been an amazing conversation. I just want to thank all of the panelists, Norm, Grant, Alora, Andy, for your time today. And for everyone tuning in, this has been an incredible turnout. I think this is a very strong evidence that the reform conversation around proportional representation is not just among us who served on the commission, but actually reaching a larger audience. And so on that point, I do want to thank David and Jess and the entire team at the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, not only for facilitating a great process to produce this report, but now doing events like this to ensure that we have implementation and activation among the broader public. So please continue to stay engaged in this conversation. I believe we have links to the two reports we've referenced in the chat, and also feel free to contact us, any of us online, if you have additional questions. So thank you all so much. Look forward to continuing the conversation. And thanks again to all of our panelists.